So good morning, welcome to this session organized by Le Monde Afrique and the WEF about agriculture in Africa. I'm Serge Michel, the editor of Le Monde Afrique, which is a new venture of Le Monde, an African edition of our website lemonde.fr, which is the leading website in France. And we have created Le Monde Afrique to address the African audience, both on the continent and the diaspora. I'm here replacing, at the last minute, a reporter from Le Monde who has been a bit too long in Burundi and couldn't get out. So I will try to do it in English. If you prefer the simultaneous translation, just tell me. I can speak French as well. Agriculture, the topic this morning. This is, we've heard many fancy things about Africa here in Cape Town, about new technologies, new cities, amazing startups. But we all know here that the key is agriculture. Agriculture for the is having kind of a huge momentum right now, as Africa is clearly accelerating its production. This session here owes a lot to Grow Africa initiative. Grow Africa is a WEF and has been a WEF initiative that has been kind of incubated in Geneva for 2 years and will now be transferred into Africa, here in South Africa actually. This initiative has raised $10 billion commitments to invest in African producers, and from 200 companies. So it's a very amazing initiative, and it has held his two-day session here the last 2 days. So we pay a tribute to them. As you see with this Grow Africa initiative, there is money for agriculture in Africa, there is awareness, but there are also major challenges. How to secure land ownership, it's one of them. How to connect stakeholders all along the value chain, and how to open regional markets. To discuss this matter, we have a very passionate panelist here, four panelists. I will introduce them to you. James, called Jim, is the executive vice president of DuPont. Or DuPont, how do you say?
You say it the right way.
DuPont. Gerardine, just next to me, is the agriculture minister of Rwanda. Monica is a lawyer, but she is also a food entrepreneur in Zambia. And Kanayo is leading the International Fund for Agriculture Development in Rome. And he's also the voice of millions of African smallholder farmers. Should I say so?
You're right.
Good. And let me start with him, actually, because Kanayo, your friends describe you as an optimist. And I think we need it, because many people are very concerned about Africa. They say the population will double in 30 years, but the food production will not double. So a disaster is possible. Tell us, how will Africa avoid this disaster?
Well, thank you very much, Serge, and thanks to Grow Africa and WEF Africa for giving us this opportunity to interact with you this morning. I am an optimist, but at the same time, I believe I'm a critic, critic of governments and political leaders, but I don't think that's what we're going to be talking about today. But why am I very optimistic? Essentially, it's very simple mathematics. Food production in Africa, and this cuts across crops, livestock, fisheries, and the rest of it, is mainly produced by small producers, smallholders, or small-scale farmers. And I want to be very clear, when I speak of farmers, I'm speaking of crops, livestock, husbandry, men and women, or women and men, rather. Now, if they are the primary producers of food in the continent, obviously, the question is, how do we make them to be more productive? The issue is one of productivity. Well, yes. Africa is home to about 60% of all available agricultural land, uncultivated agricultural land. But I say that's not the issue. For me, that is a strategic reserve. It's Africa's strategic reserve, uncultivated agricultural land. And we don't even have to touch it, for the simple reason that our small producers, whom most people describe as subsistence farmers, are basically engaged in a business that has failed. Why do I say it has failed? Because productivity, on the average, is at 40% of its potential. Mm. Now, if current production is only 40% of its potential, what does that mean? We have to increase productivity of existing farming systems. It has to become modern. And without trying to answer all your questions in my first response, yes. I will simply say that the potential is there, the policies have to be in place, infrastructure, connectivity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm sure we're going to be talking about this. So my message is very simple. And by the way, let me say that I am very, very gratified to hear how the international community, African leaders, stakeholders have adopted, accepted the fact that smallholder agriculture is here to stay.
Yeah.
The question is, how can we transform it? The transformation of African agriculture is a transformation of smallholder agriculture. And because they live in rural areas, it means a transformation of the rural space.
I would say even DuPont admitted that fact. I mean, DuPont is a company that has provided solutions for very large farms in America. And now you are here in Africa and you are really committed to smallholder farmers. Can you explain us how you bridge the gap between your size and their size? I mean, how such a large multinational can address issues for smallholder farmers? And maybe tell us a bit about your experiences in Ethiopia. Are they scalable to the whole continent or not?
Great. First, let me reinforce what Kanayo said about the importance of smallholder farmers. You know, if we look at the most recent FAO statistics around 805 million chronically malnourished people, what many people don't understand is over half of those are smallholder farmers and their families. So we're not going to solve the food security or the poverty alleviation goals we have if we don't transform life and business for smallholder farmers. So it is critical. But I'm really optimistic about that as well. As DuPont, we do serve large farmers around the world, but we've been in business here in Africa, particularly in the seed business, for several decades. And what we find are, no matter what size the farmer, farmers are interested in new technology. Mm-hmm. They're willing to embrace new practices. And even subsistence farmers, when they have access to new tools and new capabilities, become business people. And so we're having really outstanding success helping smallholder farmers move from open pollinated varieties of maize that they've planted for decades without any improvement, just to modern hybrid seeds. And as long as they have the access to quality seeds and the agronomic advice, the education to be able to know how to use them, they can significantly improve their productivity. You ask about scalability. The project in Ethiopia that you alluded to is a collaboration between USAID and the Ministry of Agriculture in Ethiopia and DuPont, and it's aimed at accelerating advanced maize seed adoption, but it includes not just the seeds and the training, but also post-harvest storage and financing and some of the other critical elements to help the farmer really work. And we've scaled that from a few hundred farmers targeted the first year to now aiming at 100,000 farmers. So we're growing rapidly with that particular project. But what's more exciting, I think, is that it's working well enough that we've started projects now with USAID in both Ghana and Zambia. So we're driving it both scalable but also replicable.
Okay. Gerardine, Your government in Rwanda has substantially improved the livelihood of farmers in the recent years. But now, apparently, the next challenge is investment in production, in transformation units and production units. And for that, many people here expect privatization plans, especially in dairy business. What are your plans in privatization?
Rwanda is a country where the ownership of land for livestock or agriculture is totally private. So the small-scale farmers, they own their land. To be able to grow whatever they are growing and scale it up, there is all the time and needs for models that can integrate them, because we don't have the chance of having land for other people to come and invest it. So the most important thing is that how do you design models that are integrating them into the system. But when it comes to the privatization, the government is doing many ways of catalyzing investments. That means we are busy dealing with setting up basic infrastructures such as roads and energy in the rural areas. We have been busy establishing ways of easing business. So we have been establishing what we call the one-stop centers. That means that you have to go to this one office and everything that you need, you can find it there, so that you don't have to be running between offices and running into bureaucracies. So trying to make lives easier for whoever wants to come, but all the time doesn't work that way. So you may be having this, needing this agro-processing unit, but you don't have him or her tomorrow or yesterday the way you wanted her or him. That means the government is stepping in, trying to catalyze them to come in, and there are some areas that we try to start the business, and then we can attract someone to come in and do the PPP with us. So we have been trying to look at it in a comprehensive way that can make easy for anyone who wants to come in to be able to come in.
Okay. I have the chance to have half of the panelists being women here, so I will use it. First, Monica, I just wanted to know, you are a lawyer. You've had senior positions in private practice. You are on the board of major companies and institutions. But you also have a food company. And how did you come to do precisely that food?
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm really delighted to be here representing African business in agribusiness. And as you can see from the panel, I'm probably the only one representing African private sector. And I think it's important because, first of all, I come from Zambia, and over the past 5 years, I think you'll see that Zambia has, and it's pushing this agenda to become the breadbasket of Southern Africa. Yields in maize, in soya beans, as well as now in wheat, have now increased year in, year out, and we're a net exporter in these three crops. However, what we are seeing is the failure to actually take the opportunity on the downstream end, which is where we come in as processors. So we still export wheat in its raw form, we still export maize, and we're not processing enough of it. And for me personally, I saw it as an opportunity, being a Zambian, to try then to look into the aspect of actually producing food. And it's, I think it's a great opportunity, but definitely not without its challenges. And I think we've heard from Kanayo and from DuPont as well about the aspects on the other side, about how do we get the raw material. You know, how do we get it to where we are, the processes? How do we get the quantities, the quality, you know, the consistency? How do we deal with high costs of labor? How do we deal with high costs of distribution? Mm. High costs of power? How do we then produce an end product, which is then for the consumer who can then buy it? So we've had a number of challenges, but we're not discouraged, because I think what we're seeing is proactivity from governments. In Southern Africa, there's much more talking, much more collaboration, so a lot more around export. And I think it encourages us, although we're still small, but we're still very interested in producing more food and producing the right types of food.
But what took you to food? I mean, why did you invest in food and not in, I don't know, high-tech companies or startups?
Sure, but I think you have to see it broadly. And I think this is where we're missing, and it's a really important point, particularly for youth involvement in agriculture. It's not just being a farmer. Excuse me. It's not about just being a farmer. It's about understanding how do you get it to market. So if your farmer is in the rural area, how does he know the price of tomato? Now that's technology, the use of technology in agriculture. Who is creating those apps? It's youth. And so I think you have to bring a much broader view to agriculture now, so you have more involvement from the youth. And I think I am youth, so I'm on the processing side. But I think I'm now looking at the market to say, actually, this market no longer wants just maize meal. Now they're looking at instant noodles, which is made from wheat. They're looking at fortified cereals, which now deals with nutrition. So I think, in my view, that this is exactly the sector we want to be. The statistics are clear. I mean, why not be in agriculture? I think we've been in mining before, and Zambia is a very strong mining country. But agriculture is where the potential is, and we can really, actually, for private sector, play a part.
I agree, I understand the value chain, but still you need a farmer at the beginning of the chain, and the farmers are getting older and older. Young people tend to prefer cities where life is more exciting. How do you think it should be done to keep the young, the youth in the fields? Because this will probably be the solution to provide jobs to the many new Africans coming. So how do you think we should organize it to keep the youth in the fields?
Again, I think I'm going to say it again. It's not just about being a farmer in the field. You have to look at it as agribusiness.
Sure. But then you need someone
Can I say something here?
Yes.
I think this is where, if you want young people to go into farming, primary production, Monica is right. I mean, producing food is not just farming. Primary production is the whole value chain. There's no incentive for a young person, a woman or man, to stay in a village, in a rural area that has no energy, no electrification, no irrigation water, you name it, no roads, no financial services. They want to migrate. So what do you do? Is the business of government to provide those facilities, basic infrastructure. Unless you, like I said before, unless you achieve rural transformation that makes the rural space attractive, that these rural villages grow to become rural towns, and they have the same attraction for people to make a living than to migrate to our cities. Having said that, I must say that in the last 4 years since we have participated in Grow Africa, I'm very impressed by two things. One, the number of young people that are participating in Grow Africa and WEF Africa. Two, the number of domestic African private sector CEOs. Monica is one of them, and they are young. So there's hope for the future. Now, government should play its part. And this is very crucial. For me, this is the biggest challenge for Africa. Political leaders, champions, and good governance.
Serge, if I could add and to build on one of Monica's points, we think that helping the next generation get involved in agriculture broadly, agriculture and food, is really critical. That's why back in 2012, when we laid out our food security goals for 2020, one of them was to engage at least 2 million young people in a way that hopefully would inspire them to get engaged. And Monica mentioned the importance of thinking about it more broadly. One of the projects we've been working on with some local organizations is an enterprise gardens project in the schools, where young people have a chance to be part of a gardening project. What do they learn? They learn obviously some agriculture and horticultural technology, but they learn they sell the produce, so they start to learn about business. They learn about nutrition. They learn about responsibility. They learn a lot of life skills. We've been tracking the kids, and before they had exposure to the project, because they came from rural areas, mostly subsistence. Less than 25% had any interest in being involved in agriculture. After just 1 year of working with the Gardens Project and seeing that agriculture and food is much broader and actually much different than just the subsistence level. It could be high tech. There's new applications, new things they could do, new opportunities. Over 80% said, we might be interested in pursuing. Now, these are young kids, but if we can all work to just open their minds and see it more broadly and not just as an extension of what they saw at home for now, but that they could make it different, I think we can have a big impact.
Okay. Geraldine, you want to?
Yeah, I wanted to comment on the food production side. You said that the farmers are getting younger, how do we attract the youth into that? In an African context, the farmers have been the poor people. How do we rebrand agriculture to bring it back in a fancy world that the youth feels like I have to go there? So with the era, with the technology and transformation, I think we need to get out of the context of someone spending a whole day in the field with their horse. So we need to come up with the technologies that are easing way of doing agriculture, but also make sure that we are rebranding it. So we get out of the context where the farmer is a poor people who spend his whole life just struggling. So it has to be something that is not a struggle.
I understand. I want to be back on the women, because you probably know, but women produce about 80% of the food in Africa. They only own 2% of the land. And it's an issue, because I've seen a study from the World Bank. I think it was based in Burkina Faso, but the study can be applied almost everywhere in Africa. In a couple, husband and wife, systematically the husband keeps the best parcel to cultivate and gives his wife the least productive parcel. The World Bank has calculated that if you just swap the parcels between the husband and the wife, national production would increase by 20%. Like, women are better cultivators, better farmers, they work harder, and if they were given a better land, it would just increase production without changing too many other factors. So, Geraldine, Rwanda has been quite innovative recently, and do you think there are ways to kind of empower women on farming?
Actually, in Rwanda, empowering women doesn't mean just women. It means empowering the community in general. So Dr. Kanayo has said it, but Rwandan women are smallholders as anyone else in the community, but also they own a small piece of land. In addition, they are the majority of the population that we have, which means that they are owners of the land. And as I said before, in Rwanda, the land is private. It belongs to the owner. So that means in Rwanda, the women, they own land. That's not a question. But what do you do with those pieces of land that they have? So that's to make them productive. That's where we need the policies that are strengthening the ways of doing business, having access to the financial capital to be able to invest on that land. So policies that have been directed towards gearing that has been like land consolidation. We have pieces of land, so to make sure that you are having them in a piece of land that can be accepted by a bank as a collateral, it has to be a big kind of land. So that means no one is losing his right to the land, but the ones who are having lands that are close to each other, they put them in common. And then to be able to have a legal voice, they have to be grouped into cooperatives. So the cooperative has an entity, a legal entity, but also has a piece of land that can be used as a collateral so that they can have a voice, go there, and be able to access to the finance. But The still issue is that is the finance group seeing that as the strongest something that should be, they should be excited to be lending to. So that's where the struggle is still is, but with time we are hoping that it's going to be unlocked. Another thing is that these women, you don't want them to spend the whole day in the field. How do you bring in technologies that are easing their lives? So how do you make sure that she doesn't spend her whole life going out to get water or the firewood? So that's where the technologies of biogas and the other technologies that are easing lives to them have to come in so that they can have time to work on their land, but also make their families live. Another thing that the statistics that we are still having in Rwanda is that probably 70% of women are still at the production stage. So the struggle is also how do you integrate them into other components of the chains? How do you make them input suppliers? How do you make them integrated into the agro-processing units instead of having in mind that every single woman has to be working on the field as a producer? So trying to bridge the gaps and make sure that they are integrated into the whole value chain, it's really critical. Thank you.
Kanayo, I think you seem to agree on everything, but is from your point of view, Rwanda an exception on that, or you think?
I think Rwanda has been very, very successful in transforming its agricultural sector and is still doing it. I think the key factor, as I said earlier, is you have political leadership that is not only committed, but is taking action. And this is, for me, it is very simple. If you look at African countries where you have successful agricultural systems or transformation taking place, you'll find that you have political leadership at the highest level of government, one, and within his cabinet, he or she has a champion, hopefully the Minister for Agriculture or the Minister for Finance. In the case of Nigeria, it's the same. Ethiopia, Meles, many of you will remember in the 80s, Ethiopia was a hopeless case. It was banned aid. 30 years later, Ethiopia has become one of Africa's fastest growing economy. Largest producer of honey, largest heads of cattle, very productive and attractive leather industry. Somebody said that by 2025, Ethiopia will produce 80% of all the shoes that are worn in Africa. I had that yesterday. Infrastructure development, roads, rural areas. I can go on and on. Second largest horticultural industry in Africa. Second largest, fourth in the world, Ethiopia. How did it happen? Take Tanzania. So I think here we're looking at leadership that actually takes action. Enough of declarations and commitments. Action is the proof of conviction. And this is why I'm very hopeful. You know, okay, we say 11 of the 20 fastest growing economies are in Africa. But look at those 11 countries. Most of them are growing, there's economic growth as a result of extractive industries.
Yes.
And if I may just take this to a logical conclusion, most African countries do not need development assistance to transform. Why? We're the richest continent in the world. 2013, $394 billion from extractive industries. Oil, gas, diamond, gold, $394 billion. Nigeria, 2012-2013, $86 billion revenue, oil. Angola, $76 billion. I can give you all the figures. And yet, we spent $35 billion importing food. What I say to my ministers and presidents, do you know you are spending $35 billion every year providing jobs for people outside the continent while we have youth unemployment of 35% and growing? Come on, does it make sense?
So you insisted on governance and local champions, but the fact is that also smallholder farmers and all the value chain needs investment money. Have you seen this money coming to? I mean, what are the good practices? What are the success stories that make you optimistic on this? Apart from Ethiopia, because I'm not sure Ethiopia has received so much foreign investment, for example.
Well, it did, but it put it into good use. I think Jim has just given us a good example of what DuPont pioneer is doing. We have many. I think, first of all, we have to have financial services that are inclusive financing. And many African countries are engaged in this. And I hope that when we meet in Addis in July on financing for development, this is going to be a topic of significant importance. Mm. There's many institutions that are working together with governments to provide financing for small producers. I think the recognition that agriculture or farming, no matter what scale or size, is first and foremost a business. We didn't say this 5 years ago, because most people, including some of us in this room, saw small producers, as Geraldine said, as poor people waiting for handouts. I have traveled the length and breadth of this continent. I have eaten with small producers. I have dined with ministers and presidents. I tell you, they want exactly the same things for themselves and their family like everybody in the city. And they have ideas. Why will a farmer in a remote village in Zambia have a solar panel in a thatch roof? Not just because they want to watch football. They want their children to be able to study at night so they can move out into Lusaka and go to college. So the point here is financial inclusion is going to be very key. And as has been said, women should have equal access to financial services, because we know in the agricultural sector, women are better managers. Well, rural women, let me be more correct, rural women are better managers of resources. We know it. Payback of loans is about 96% for women. Men, if you're lucky, 60%, 70%. And women invest it to feed their children, for health, for medication, etc. I mean, I can go on and on, but I let my colleagues speak.
We'll let a woman speak. Monica, this question of importation and how to replace these imports that are, of course, an absurdity for Africa to import so much food. You produce food, you sell sophisticated food to new emerging middle classes. How do you see it? I mean, how can you switch and replace imports by local products?
Yes. I think, first of all, a very important statistic just came out by Dr. Kanayo about the fact that we're exporting jobs. And it's when you hear that, it's actually quite frightening. But the problem is, and it's a really big problem for producers such as ourselves, so to compete with a lot of cheap imports coming in from all over the world. And this is because as a producer, we're faced with a number of very high costs, and competition is very difficult. And so the same discussion around enabling environment also applies to the sort of downstream area as well. I mean, we have issues around distribution, around access to the raw material, which increase the cost of the actual food. I'll give you a simple example of packaging. So we can grow the food, grow the raw material, actually create the food, and then have to import the packaging. So for me to compete with a product from Turkey, a product from even South Africa, it's really difficult. And so what we try to do is actually engage government much more, where we feel that as producers in Zambia, we have strength to say perhaps we have to have a much more vigorous policy, for instance, around cereals, this is just an example, or around milk, dairy. Zambia is doing very, very well in dairy. And is there a need for imports for dairy? What can we do as producers to make sure that there are no shortages of dairy products? And then speak to government about it, but the enabling environment to reduce costs, to increase production for ourselves, to increase markets are important, as well as not only just looking at the local market, but also the regional market. And government, again, plays a very a very strong role in making sure we have access to regional markets as well.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And the food that you are producing and selling, do you have any imported elements on it, apart the packaging?
Yes, we do. We do, absolutely. And it's just a function of the country that we're in. As we can, I say, well, a bulk of the product is locally sourced, which is wheat or maize or soya. But things like packaging are still imported. The actual basic packaging is still imported. Okay. And those are things we have to deal with. But I think with time, someone else will have to come into the packaging industry. I mean, it is so much harder for us to do everything. And we hope that that increases economic activity in the country. Because if we have a strong processing industry, then the packaging industry should surely then come up.
Sure. But you know, the processing industry, I mean, Ivory Coast is the world champion of cacao. But the first chocolate factory opened 10 days ago there. So it's really striking to see that somehow the colonial economy has persisted to export raw materials from Africa and to re-import processed food. Jim, what do you have to say about it? Because you are on several steps on the value chain, transformation, imports.
First of all, if we start at the beginning of the chain, clearly there's huge opportunity to improve productivity on the farm. But as Monica said, you know, that creates opportunities. And in our food ingredients business, we're not as far along in Africa as we are in other parts of the world because that processed food industry is only really just getting started locally. And so how do we encourage more investment there, you know, whether it's packaging or whether it's local food companies. And governments need to have the right kind of policy or enabling environment, but then how do we make sure that people are willing to make investments, local companies get started and invest and grow? That creates jobs that can move people off of the farms in the rural areas that want to go and actually go to, yes, to good jobs. It creates more and better food, longer shelf lives, more nutritious food. So we need to think of it as a system, and we need to keep doing everything we can from wherever we sit to encourage building out that value chain.
Okay. I had a question for you. I don't know at what time I should ask it, but there is a controversial issue on your company and some others with the genetically modified seeds. Mm. DuPont is a major producer of it, and it's a controversial issue in Africa and in Europe. I think Ghana is now in the process of having a court case about GMO. Mm. Do you think GMO is a must for Africa, or can Africa feed itself without using them?
So, first of all, GMOs are making a huge impact around the world on farmer productivity already in an increasing number of countries. Millions and millions of farmers, in fact, the majority are smallholder farmers that are benefiting from the technology, places like the Philippines and India and China. So, and several decades now of safe and productive use. So they are a very, very useful tool. That said, on the African continent, at this point, South Africa is the only country that's using them. We have a good seed business there that involves GMOs. They're helping farmers with their productivity. But it's not a silver bullet. Farmers need all the tools in the toolbox. And so, you know, in the meantime, we're very active. We talked about Ethiopia before, Zambia, Kenya, Tanzania. We have a growing seed business just helping farmers move from where they are today with unimproved open pollinated varieties to modern seeds. So it's not required to start the process. It would be a valuable tool at some point when governments and societies get comfortable with it to move forward. But in the meantime, there's work to do, and let's keep working on it.
I think we need to be very cautious with the question, like the question you just asked. And I think Jim actually gave you a partial answer. Biotechnology by itself is a tool. Mm. Okay. On one end, you have GMOs, genetically modified crops. On the other hand, you have molecular biology that helps you to breed better crops, high yielding, resistant or tolerant to stresses. So it's a tool. I think oftentimes when we say GMOs, we just think of transgenics. Mm. It's not just transgenics. Mm. So genetically modified systems do not necessarily have to be transgenics. But having said that, there are stresses where there's no other solution. For example, drought. Mm. Drought-tolerant maize. I mean, how are you going to develop seed varieties that are drought-resistant without going through GM technology? But I want to give you the other side of the coin. See, because if you ask me that question, I would say, no, we don't need GMOs. But I say, but. Where is the but? In my first contribution, I said that Africa's farming systems are described as subsistence because they are a failed business. They are not producing at their potential. They are, on the average, 40%. Why is that so? 5% of our agricultural land is irrigated. India, South Asia, 40%. Latin America, 90%. Our farmers, on the average, use 13 kilograms per hectare of fertilizer. 90 kilograms in South Asia. 190 kilograms in Latin America. Jim just said it. Even growing simply improved high-yielding varieties, HYVs, is exceptional. Maybe with maize. Maybe here in South Africa. Everywhere else is traditional crops. So by simple, with irrigation and high-yielding varieties, you can multiply production and productivity by 5. So when I say, please, our 60% unused agricultural land in the world, which is in Africa, don't touch it yet until you optimize existing systems. That's the whole thing. So what are the incentives for these small producers to produce more? Can they take it to the market when it rains and there are no roads? Do they have market information when to sell? Do they have storage facilities to store it for 2 weeks when prices go up, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? Do they have access to finances?
The other controversial issue is land grabbing, as they say. And do you see that in your countries? I mean, in Rwanda, do you have... we always hear that Indian, Chinese, or companies from the Gulf are getting large pieces of land. Is that an issue in Rwanda?
As I said, in Rwanda, we don't have land to grab, first of all, because we don't have such huge land to give away. But again, these farmers in Rwanda, they are the owners of 90% of the land available. So as a government, we cannot afford to take these people away and give their land away, which means, coming back to what I said before, how do we integrate models, develop models that are integrating them where they are, but also be productive and business owners? So the land grabbing is going around, but for us as a government, I don't think that we are ready to give away land as such, because we don't have any. But I think also in other countries, it's one way of giving incentives to companies to come in, but for us, we don't have land to grab.
Maybe there is more land to grab in Zambia, right?
definitely more land, that's for sure. But I think what we find in Zambia is that the strength of partnerships and the strength of government trying to get more private sector involvement, be it local or foreign, into agriculture. So yesterday, and actually I know this from a very large German agriculture company, which has now just acquired over 10,000 hectares in Zambia. We're actually lucky that we can actually give away 10,000 hectares. But I think it's there is a definite consultation process with government to understand what is the use of the land. I mean, I think the belief is that if something productive is going to be done to improve yields, to improve definitely training, so we understand how to grow better crops and a different crop, I don't think the government of Zambia would be opposed to it. But I think for being maybe a domestic company, we would like to see a much more clear, consistent, and transparent process with respect to land ownership or mm-hmm. land acquisition and partnerships. And I think that's what we ask for. But I think Zambia is in a very unique place. I mean, we are a very large country with a lot of water, and so irrigation is not required, but it's definitely something they look into. But again, it's really partnerships, working partnerships for the benefit of Zambia and the region.
Okay. I would like to take some questions from the audience. I would ask you to introduce yourself briefly.
Ms. Musidi Mudise, I'm a global shaper to the Tswane Hub in South Africa. More so, I'm part of an organization that is committed to creating multiple agripreneurs, one country and one continent at a time. My question is around the importance of research in the context of agriculture. How can we make it more simplified and accessible to the end users whose literacy levels are not oftentimes to the adequate level? Like, the issue of sustainability is becoming increasingly more important in agriculture. But to kind of explain it to the end user being the farmer, what can we do to kind of localize it and simplify issues like that? Thanks.
Maybe Monica or Jim?
I'll start. First of all, that's a really important point because as a global company, we invest in advancing science. Science can be global, but the solutions have to be local, and your point is right on that. The challenge we have, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, is with the large number of smallholder farmers physically finding ways to get the information and the education to be able to put that science to use in a constructive way is a challenge. So we're experimenting with different approaches, trying to find ways to use technology to make it simpler, et cetera. But one of the things that's really a challenge is the lack of extension services, whether they be government or private. And so, you know, we do some things on our own, but we really are looking for partners to help, accelerate that transfer of knowledge, because the research is one thing, but getting it in the hands, the information in the hands of the people is the big thing. But I would also add that while private industry does a lot of research, we really can't do it all. There are some things that governments or universities, et cetera, we really need to have. So we're also encouraging governments to think about investing more in agricultural research and development. There are some aspects that that would be helpful to the whole system. So we do need more investment in research, but I think the key thing from our point of view is how do we get that in the hands of the farmers, and it's gonna take new approaches and collaboration.
Sure. And it's a great question, because on a practical basis, we're faced with that every day and trying to understand how actually the extension workers program works. And they have a number of challenges: infrastructure, transportation, receiving allowances on time, actually even updating their own information. They're a very important part of the chain, because they're the ones who go into rural areas to train, to teach farmers about pest control, about better methods, etc. And so what we have found at private sector is that in order for us to ensure our raw material supply, we've had to really fund that aspect to assist government to pay for transportation for them to go to that area, or else the problem is that you actually won't get the raw material. So what we've done, and I think it's a partnership, but it is definitely a cost for private sector, and we're trying to find ways in which to subsidize that. So for us, we have ended up speaking to many more impact funders to say, look, you know, we want to produce, but maybe fund this aspect of the value chain so that the extension worker is able to go out to the rural areas, able to engage the farmer in order for them to deliver on what we want.
Yeah. Other questions? Yes, madam.
First rank.
Good morning, panelists. Thank you so much for your excellent presentations this morning. My name is Suzanne Matale, and I'm a social justice activist from Zambia. Listening to this panel, I in my mind, I'm thinking about the important aspect of access to finance. In my experience in Zambia, that finance is very expensive because an ordinary peasant farmer cannot borrow money from the bank because the interest rates are. And so the many people who come to grab our land can borrow money from outside, where it's cheaper, so that they can do what they have to do. But also the tension between what is state land and customary land. Because many people do not have title, especially the peasant farmers, to the land, which means they will have no collateral to go and borrow finance, which is a, you know, it's a necessary prerequisite in terms of improving our farming. I'm wondering what the thoughts are of our panelists on these issues. And of course, I say this because I fully resonate that the government has a bigger role to play in terms of laying the environment, policy, regulation, and all that, and infrastructure. Thank you so much.
Well, I can start off by saying that one of the pillars of IFAD's, my institution's engagement and the portfolios that we support with national governments is access to finance, or inclusive financing, rural finance. And I do know that we are supporting at least one or two ongoing projects in Zambia which have components of financing for smallholder producers. And I think there are many microfinance institutions now. Uh-huh. And I know that also what we're trying to do is how we can bring down the costs of microfinance, because some microfinance institutions charge very exorbitant interest rates. And in this area also, we're looking at remittances. Remittances globally has, at least I think it's now about $500 billion. It dwarfs ODA completely. Now, remittances also, sometimes you pay as high as 20%, in some places 40% to remit money back home. How can you bring it down? I think there's this 5x5, bringing remittance, cost of remittances to less than 5% in 5 years. So there are many microfinance institutions across Africa. And as I said, this is one of our major areas of work.
What is the average rate of interest for a smallholder farmer to get some
finance?
Sorry,
what was the question?
What is the rate, the average rate for?
What we do is we support microfinance institutions so that farmers can access these. And because we provide in the programs, we provide subsidies to take care of the administrative costs of the microfinance institutions. So farmers get to pay about 5% on loans. And it works many ways. I mean, our best stories come from Ethiopia, where we have inclusive financing programs that are doing extremely well in rural areas. But very quickly on land titling, I know that the African Union Commission is working very, very hard. I mean, they have put in place, I can't remember the exact title, but had to do with land rights. And the Rome-based UN agencies working with the World Bank, you may know, have the voluntary guidelines as well as responsible investment in agriculture to actually support governments to achieve as much as possible optimization of land titling for producers themselves. In some countries, land is owned by government. In others, it's owned by communities. So you have to take it on a case-by-case basis. But there are processes in place that are looking at how to help governments develop policies that will ensure that producers own their land, and ownership will then belong to both the wife and the husband. And in case the husband passes away, it passes on to the wife and not to the uncle or to the brother of the husband.
Hmm. Monica, you want
just
to
two
say
seconds,
something?
Yes, because being a Zambian, I think the question is very pertinent, because in Zambia, actually, the formal banking system is actually not available to the smallholder farmer. And it's because the formal banking system is not designed to bank the smallholder because of the concept of security. They just do not understand it. And because there's no title, they would not lend. Mm-hmm. And it's because, one, the banking system has done what they've always done, is make money in the way they've always made it. And so they do not understand the system outside of that realm. And so for them, security will always be land or something more of a fixed asset. So where you step beyond that, then they're unable to lend. And interest rates in Zambia are 24% and above. Mm-hmm. So you're already failing before you start. But the thing is, I think what we have to do and where government of Zambia has to step up is think differently around the agricultural sector, particularly for the smallholder farmer, to look around guarantee, loan guarantee, or to pull the smallholder farmers together through some form of cooperative and have the cooperative borrow and they guarantee it. Mm-hmm. Private sector banks will not do that. It's not what they're designed for. They have their shareholders who are looking to make money the way they've always done it. But really, we need more innovation around financing these kind of sectors, or else we're not going to see the growth or the investment that's required.
Yes, another question, a last one, because we have to get slowly to conclusion, and then I will.
Thank you. The issue of land is very emotional. In South Africa, there is a challenge with respect to who owns land. In terms of growth with equity, the structure or the model that is developing in Zambia, where huge swaths of lands are being sold to multinationals, to what extent is that sustainable?
Go ahead.
I must say I don't represent the government of Zambia, so I will be very careful in that response. I think that's the impression perhaps being created, that huge tracts of land are, everything is being sold to foreigners. But to be fair, there are very large Zambian commercial farmers and who are doing quite successful. But I think what we should be encouraging more is more Zambians to get involved in actually farming, but on a larger scale. And what can we do to encourage Zambian farmers to get, you know, to become bigger? Because the statistic is real, and Dr. Kanaya, I'm sure you can tell me that 82% of farming in Zambia is done by small-scale farmers. Those are Zambians. So what are we going to do about transitioning that 82% to go into the 20% or 18%, but become larger commercial farmers?
Jardine?
I'm not sure about how viable is the giving away land, but I just wanted to come back to the access to finance, because that's a big issue that the smallholders are doing. So what we have been doing in Rwanda is trying to be innovative in different ways by creating guarantees, matching grants, having farmers in a cooperative so that they can have that legal voice. But it seems like the formal financial institutions, they don't have the culture of lending into the agriculture. So there is a huge capacity building needs at both financial institutions, because most of them, they are used to applications for buying houses, vehicles. So how do you help them to have someone who understands agriculture to be part of their staff? How do you get someone who is going to be evaluating loan applications to be agriculture sensitive? That's a campaign that has been going around to try, to the extent that we are mobilizing some of them to actually create like an agricultural department within the commercial banks. But still, it's a long way to go. Another way that has been done, Dr. Kanayo has said, it is having the micro financial institutions down in the community. We have what we call circles, which means these people, they have, you know, the people working in the circles, they come from the same community, so that they can be comfortable to be doing what they are doing. But something else for the farmers, when they are applying for loans, they are not as perfect as you think that I can be when I'm doing my business plan to go to get a loan. So there is also a huge need of capacity building on that side to make sure that these farmers' cooperatives are well equipped to be able
to make convincing projects that can be submitted to the bank for loans. So it has to be addressed in a comprehensive way from the producers, but also at the high level, at the bank level, because it's not an easy thing that the bank will jump at in a second.
Okay, I thank you all. I think we have reached the time, and I'm being Swiss, from Swiss origin, I have to respect the time. So thank you, everybody. I think we have addressed some of the issues in agriculture. It's, of course, a very wide topic. I think you gave us some of your optimism, and
yes.
No?
I hope
do
yes.
You agree? Everybody agrees?
Yes.
And there is optimism from his side. There is pragmatism that we see in Rwanda, quite successful transforming country. And so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.